This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today we're going to have a show that I have long wanted to do, but I have not had the right person to do it with. Now I do. Mark Anthony, who is an attorney, Oxford-educated attorney. He calls himself the psychic lawyer. Not only is he an Oxford-educated attorney who practices in this country, the United States, he's a fourth-generation psychic medium who communicates with spirits. This, like in my family, this goes back a long time in his family, but longer than in mine. He has practiced before the United States Supreme Court, so he is a very accomplished attorney. He travels to mystical locations in different parts of the world to observe and examine ancient mysteries and supernatural phenomena. He's been on TV. He's been on Gaia TV, Beyond Belief with George Noory. He's the host of the psychic, co-host of The Psychic and the Doc on the Transformation Network. And he is a columnist for Best Holistic Life magazine and the best-selling author of two books, Never Letting Go and Evidence of Eternity. His new book is quite incredible. It's called The Afterlife Frequency. And boy, do I relate to this. His website is afterlifefrequency.com. Mark Anthony, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you, Whitley. It's an honor to be here.
Well, it's good to have you. And there are a lot of new terms and concepts in the book, at least for people who are maybe somewhat outside of the experience. But if you're inside the experience, you know that there's something to all of this, not just to afterlife communication, but to the particular way you're looking at it. Can you describe what you mean by electromagnetic soul, for example?
Absolutely. One of the reasons that I wrote The Afterlife Frequency, Whitley, was to bring our understanding and the terminology of spirit communication into the 21st century. Because most of the terminology was developed during the golden age of spiritualism and seances in the Victorian era. So, you know, we're dealing with 150 to 170-year-old thinking, and we now have the benefit not only of quantum physics, but also neuroscience, the study of the human brain, and the last 50 years of survival of consciousness and near-death experience research. And so I developed the term the electromagnetic soul to bridge the gap between faith and spirituality. Every great belief system teaches that the soul, who and what we are, our consciousness, pre-exists the body, comes into the body, and moves on after the body dies. The laws of physics teach us that energy is neither created nor destroyed, only transferred from one form to another. We know from the field of neuroscience that the brain has an electromagnetic field. So the term electromagnetic soul describes in 21st century terms what we truly are, which is pure consciousness that is eternal electromagnetic energy.
It's so close to my own personal experience. Like, I always, just to give you an example, I have friends who are also in the same situation. And just recently, three of us all had extraordinary electromagnetic effects associated with the approach of something. I had a situation where I was waked up in the night. And on the surveillance camera, you can see a dark object come down beside my cell phone and push it off a table. And that sound woke me up. Another one who has been studied extensively for her psychokinetic abilities had a sudden eruption of psychokinetic things happening. And the third one had an absolutely remarkable, but very complex, electromagnetically related experience also. Now, How does this work? Can you give us an idea of what is the soul? And I've got so many questions. I'll just take them in order here. What is the soul in your view?
Well, the soul's who and what we are. In the realm of faith, it's referred to as the soul or spirit. In psychology and science, it's referred to as consciousness. It's our personality, our viewpoints, the who and what we are, all of that is enshrined in this energy field, this quantum electromagnetic field that we refer to as the soul. And an easy way to think of this is think of your body as a car. Okay, we are not these bodies, we're in these bodies. And so, you know, you drive your car, and I always like to joke that, you know, some people look at cars and, you know, maybe somebody's driving a Ferrari, and you're thinking, yeah, I'd like to take a spin in that one. And then other people, not so much of a broken down old junker. But the thing is, we are not these bodies. We are in these bodies. So when the body, our car, stops to ceases to function, we get out of it and we move on. And so the soul is energy. And like I was explaining before, energy is neither created nor destroyed, only transferred from one form to another. And so a lot of the naysayers, you know, say that, okay, well, you can't prove this. This doesn't exist. And it's funny because the people who claim to attack us on the basis of science seem to kind of dodge the energy neither created nor destroyed, only transferred. But who and what we are is a reality. It is a coherent quantum electromagnetic field. And when the body dies, we remain intact. It's just that we're no longer tethered to this corporeal vessel. And so the vibrational energy of our soul transfers to the higher frequency, which is what I call the afterlife frequency.
Well, this book it's very powerful because it's so practical. What I want to ask you next is this. If the soul is an electromagnetic presence, and I believe that's exactly right from my own life experience with this, which quite frankly is quite extensive at this point, what would be necessary for us to begin to be able to measure it scientifically? Because I know, I sense that's possible, but at the same time, it's conscious. And for example, when things happen around here, this house is filled with surveillance cameras. I've got two different systems, Google Nest and Simply Safe, all the cameras in the house. But I very often have a situation where I don't see anything, but the cameras turn themselves off, and I do feel a very strong presence. It's sometimes overwhelmingly strong. How can we, if this energy is there, but it doesn't want to be seen or maybe measured, what are your ideas about what to do about that? If in a perfect world, how could we begin to learn to measure this in a repeatable way that would convince science?
Well, that's a huge part of the discussion in the afterlife frequency.
That's why I asked the question.
Yeah, I know, and I'm glad that you asked. First off, spirits are not, it's not that they don't want to be seen. And a lot of the skeptics are people who don't believe, but if you're able to produce evidence, that will persuade them. A cynic just says, oh, I don't believe that. And the skeptical attack is, well, you know, why can't we just detect the electromagnetic soul, the EMS, using QEEG, quantitative electroencephalogram, or EEG, electroencephalogram, which are the medical tests used to measure brainwave frequency and electrical flow throughout the human brain. Well, the QEEG and EEG are wonderful diagnostic tools, but they do not operate at the higher resonance, the higher frequencies, which would be necessary to quantify and actually track the EMS, the electromagnetic soul. That being said, there is a whole plethora of paranormal investigation equipment, all of which scans the EM spectrum, There's K2 meters, EVP, electronic voice phenomenon. There's infrared. There is ultraviolet scanners. All of those are different forms of electromagnetic energy. And when we're doing paranormal investigations, you look for anomalies in those fields, which very well could be this coherent EMS electromagnetic soul of a discarnate intelligence. In other words, a spirit. Now, that being said, we have rudimentary technology now, the paranormal investigation equipment. Back in the 1920s, Thomas Edison was interviewed several times in magazines, and he indicated that he was working on a device sensitive enough to tune into spirits. And it was nicknamed by the media as the spirit phone. But since Edison, there have been the paranormal investigation equipment, but now at the University of Arizona, Dr. Gary Schwartz, who incidentally wrote the foreword for the Afterlife Frequency, is developing what is known as the Soul Phone. And the Soul Phone project is employing 21st century technology. He's got a team of computer specialists and electrical engineers, and they're working on creating a device sensitive enough to tune into and communicate with the afterlife frequency. Now, I would love to tell you what I've seen in his laboratory because I'm on the board of directors of the Soul Phone project, but I had to sign an NDA, a non-disclosure agreement. So I would love to tell you, but being an attorney, I know better than to violate that. Plus, I wouldn't do that to my friend and colleague, Gary Schwartz. But let's leave it at this. The announcement's going to be coming. It will not be in the distant future. And I believe that in our lifetime, we very well may have devices enabling anyone to tune into the other side, the afterlife frequency. And I think that that is really going to shake things up globally. Definitive proof of life after death. And call me an unending and eternal optimist, but I would hope that that would start getting people on this planet thinking that maybe we need to be thinking beyond me, and start thinking more globally and stop resorting so quickly to violence. But, you know, that's just my wishful thinking.
Well, you know, one of the things in speaking of electronic voice phenomenon that you hear from Dr. Constantine Rodabe, who was a pioneer in this area, one of the things he says from the other side at one point is that the problem is violence.
Yes.
He said, yes. What do you think about early research and early work of Rodabe and the others who were doing EVP? I know that Gary was very, I know Gary also, oddly enough, wrote the foreword to my book too. And he's been on this show many times.
Yeah, he's awesome, isn't he?
He's and really a great special. Friend. Oh, he and my wife, Anne, were really very friendly. And they, one of the most remarkable experiences of my life happened with Anne and him in his lab. But in any case, we're not talking about that now. What about the early EVP work? How do you evaluate it?
Well, I technology has to begin somewhere. And I think the early EVP work was good. And I think it's even better now. And if you'll indulge me for a moment, I had a very profound experience with this. My best friend and I we met when we were 11 years old, Billy. Okay, went to junior high school, college together. And after college, he went to Asia and he learned to speak Japanese, Cantonese, Thai, Indonesian. He was a linguistics genius. Who knew when we were in high school? But he had this incredible gift for Asian language. I went to law school and we were great friends. And I spent time with him in Asia. I went there and we had these incredible adventures in Japan and then later in Southeast Asia. And in fact, the Afterlife Frequency, the first chapter opens with something that happened with us in Bangkok. And right. Let me tell you, yeah, things didn't go right. I wouldn't be sitting here right now. In fact, I don't I think I'd be trying to connect with Gary Schwartz through the soul phone. In other words, I'd probably be dead.
Right. And you're going to have to tell us about that when you're finished, now that you brought it up, because I wasn't going to bring it up, but it's a great story.
No, people got to read that one. They got to read that one.
Okay, good enough. That's fair.
The thing is, and I purposely didn't put this story in the book because I knew that people would be asking me, why did you write the Afterlife Frequency? And the questions about the technology would come up. And, you know, we were such good friends that when he got married, he asked me to perform the ceremony. His wife was from Japan, and it was just one of those beautiful days in life, Whitley. I mean, there I was. I'm standing there in the role of a minister, my best friend, and I'm marrying him to the love of his life. And everybody, and I looked at the crowd, and everybody I loved was alive then. My parents were there, his parents, all my friends. It was just one of those shining stars in life. And it doesn't really get better than that. It doesn't. And everything seemed fine at first, but Billy always grappled with depression. And unfortunately, he drank way too much. And he succumbed to suicide about 3 years after that. And certainly I was devastated by this. And I remember getting the call from his wife, and she's Japanese, and she said, Mark, I don't know who else to call. The doctors want me to turn off life support. They want me to kill him. I cannot do it. And I told her, don't do it. I said, don't do it. Because I know how she is. She's so sensitive, and she would never forgive herself. I said, don't do it. 3 hours later, he expired on his own. And I've always been thankful that I was guided to tell her that. Well, a year and a half after that, Whitley, I was speaking at the Stanley Hotel in Estes Park, Colorado, at a paranormal convention. And
that is the what that movie called? The Shining.
Oh yeah. And it's funny because when we were there, they had a guy that was, he was a Jack Nicholson impersonator, and he kept going around going, here's Johnny, you know, so anyone that's a Stephen King fan or Jack Nicholson fan's aware of that. And, but the Stanley is a huge hub of paranormal activity. That's why it draws to these conventions. And so I had just spoken, and I'm down on the convention floor, and I was signing books at my table. And there was a lot of the guys and women from TV there, and they were all displaying their paranormal investigation equipment. So my manager, Rocky, she travels with me. I mentioned her quite a bit in all my books. And she was walking around looking at the investigation equipment. So she's walking by this one table, and this guy named Chris, he's running it. And as she walks by the spirit box scanner, which scans EM electromagnetic frequencies to detect voices of spirits, she's walking by this and she hears, get Mark. And she stops and she looks at this thing, and Chris is looking at her, and he goes, did that say something to you? And all of a sudden, once again, get Mark. And he goes, do you think he means your Mark, Mark Anthony? And so, you know, I'm about 50 feet away, and I'm hearing, Mark, Mark, get over here now. And I'm like, oh my God, what happened? And I run up to the table. Then there's this crowd of people forming. And as I approach it, all of a sudden I hear, dude. And I stopped. I mean, it was like, and I looked at her, and tears were coming out of her eyes. And then I heard, love you, bro. And I go, oh my God. And she goes, Mark, that was Billy's voice, because she knew him too. And I go, it was. And then it got all staticky. And I mean, I really had to do it, had to take a breather there. And then it dawned on me, our whole lives, we had this ongoing debate. He always said, I don't understand how you do that psychic thing. He said, but I don't believe in God. I don't believe in an afterlife. And there's no technology that can prove this. And what did he choose to come through to me? But a piece of technology, and it got my wheels turning, Whitley.
So cool.
That is what got me working on this book, because I figured I had to to explain to people in scientific terms and write it in a way that anybody can understand it and everybody will enjoy it with lots of stories to illustrate this.
It's loaded with stories. Mark, we have to take a break. You know, I'm not going to do a usual break, actually, this time. This is too intense. I don't want to break our attention. And what I'm going to do is this instead. I'm going to say two things. First, to the subscribers, the best advertising we have, and as you know, we intentionally don't do a great deal of advertising, is you. Tell your friends about this. Tell your friends about Dreamland and Unknown Country. And non-subscribers listening free, most of you for many, many years, why don't you turn a page and get involved? Because there's a huge amount here. Like, for example, you can listen to at least two interviews with Dr. Gary Schwartz, who we're talking about right now. Now, all of that said, we're talking to Mark Anthony. His new book is The Afterlife Frequency. Obviously, it's extremely important to anyone who is interested in taking this whole idea of communication with the dead to the next level. We can do this. And Mark is right at the cutting edge. And this book is so unbelievably useful and clarifying. And plus his website, markanthony.com. Is that correct, Mark?
It's afterlifefrequency.com, just like the book. Afterlife frequency. If you go to the other one, you're going to end up with the singer. So my website, just like my book, is afterlifefrequency.com.
And in a while, we're going to get into Mark's work. He does psychic readings and all kinds of things. And in the third half hour, we're going to explore his background as a psychic, because he comes from a generational psychic family, which is very unusual, actually. Now, but it's not very unusual, but it's unusual for a person to understand that. So go to his website and you can engage with him on his website on many different levels. Okay. Now, before we left, we were just talking about this whole business of your friend contacts you using technology.
Yes.
Now, and then you mentioned that it went to static.
Yes.
And I thought to myself, isn't that the thing that we're trying to understand right there? Why did that happen? And why would it be that if you asked for him to repeat it, you couldn't necessarily get it repeated? And this repetition is so essential to us understanding this scientifically.
There's a lot of reasons why that may happen. And what I think, and based on my experience, like when I communicate with spirits, it's all about brainwave frequency, adjusting the brainwaves of my electromagnetic soul to a higher frequency. Spirits bring theirs down. We get a frequency match. And that's how it's like tuning into a radio. And it appears that it's quite a bit of energy expenditure on the part of the spirit as well, because he had to align his frequency with this device, which, you know, yes, it's wonderful and all, but it's probably rather primitive compared to what is coming. So I think that's a big part of it. Also, he gave me everything I needed right then and there. You know, it's messages from spirits. It would be nice to get, these lengthy dissertations. And a lot of people that, come to mediums, they're expecting to get Hamlet's soliloquy from their loved ones in spirit. And instead, they may get something about, I like the apple pie that you baked. And people say, well, yeah, everybody knows I bake apple pie and I made the best apple pie and you loved it. But what does that mean? You know, and it's like, well, first off, I don't know that you bake apple pies. And secondly, I didn't know that you're famous for them. You know, so they may give pieces of information like that. Also, once you get past that, they will start giving deeper messages. But in this case, Billy reached out, and when Rocky was in, and he knew Rocky too, when she was in close proximity to this device, he's get Mark. And she recognized the voice. She said, she was standing there. She goes, I'm looking at this contraption. And Mark, Billy's voice is coming out of it saying, get you. And then when I ran up, the thing is, we grew up in East Coast, Central Florida, in the surfing culture. He always called me dude and bro. In fact, Whitley, one of the last things he ever said to me, I remember he came and hugged me, goes, love you, bro, like that. And that is what comes out of this device. So short, sweet, powerful. That's how messages with spirits are. You know, think about a lot of the things that Buddha said or Jesus said, very short, very to the point.
Yes.
Let the one among you without sin cast the first stone.
What?
Do we really need much more than that? You know?
What role does love play in this type of contact? Because it seems to me it plays a big role.
Love is huge. In my book, I teach people, because not everybody's a psychic or a medium. And too many mediums write books about, I'll turn you into a medium. And I've seen in psychic development classes, people who are just in tears and frustrated, they simply can't do it. It's because, you know, we're not all, look, I can pop around on a tennis court, but I'm not going to turn into a Roger Federer, okay? But I can pick up a tennis racket and you know, hit a ball. We're not all going to be able to do, you know, we can all do math, but we're not all going to be an Elon Musk. You know what I'm saying? It's like, we're all simply good at different things. But that being said, that's why I developed a 4-step process called the RAFT technique to teach people how to recognize, accept, feel, and trust messages from spirits. And the way that that happened to me, I was trying to figure out how to explain this to people, and I hit that dreaded writer's block. You know, and it always seems, and you're smiling, Whitley, because I know you know what that is.
I've been writing for a long time.
Yeah, and isn't it always on the day that you schedule the time to work on the book? You have the whole day, you sit down, and nothing. Okay, nothing. Nada. Can't do a thing. And that's what had happened to me. And I said, fine, I'm going to go for a walk on the beach. So I head out, I'm walking down my driveway, and all of a sudden, chills and tingles over my body. I'm like, okay, this is something spiritual. And I do an about face, head in the opposite direction, start walking down this bike path. And I see two objects shining in the sun. And I lean over to pick them up, and it's a nickel and a penny. And I hear my mother's voice, my mother in spirit, say, it's bad luck if their head's down. And I'm laughing because, you know, that side of the family's Italian. And you know, they have a superstition for all occasions. You know, don't cross your silverware, don't walk under a ladder, dear God, don't break a mirror. You know, and I'm laughing because if a coin is heads down, it's bad luck. And then I hear Dad's voice chime in, it's money, grab it. So I'm laughing. I'm laughing. I'm holding this nickel and this penny in my hand. I go, oh, 6 cents. I go, wait a second, 6 cents. And then the chills and tingles overwhelm me, and I see my dad in my mind's eye standing in the ocean with this blue canvas raft that he had when I was a kid. And, okay, Dad was a Navy SEAL. He was a scuba diver, a swimming instructor, but raft. And then it hit me. What my parents were trying to teach me is show people how to recognize signs from spirits, like the cold chills and tingles and the two coins. Except the contact is real, seeing the vision of my dad, feel without overthinking. Okay, that's where people hit a block, and then trust the message. RAFT. And it's the third step, the feel, where people overthink it. They start questioning it. It's, oh, must be a coincidence, grief-induced hallucination, it's my imagination. That's where it fizzles out. So I teach people how, not only the RAFT technique, but how to employ it and how to use it to make sense out of all forms of spirit communication. you know, whether it's a near-death experience, a deathbed vision where your a loved one is transitioning and he or she is perceiving spirits, but people in close proximity are picking up on it, contact through a medium, maybe they come to you in a visitation. You know, you do this naturally, Whitley. You know, you're a pro at this because you've had this, you know, your relationship with your wife has gone from one of a physical to one of a spiritual nature. Yeah, and so exactly. When she communicates with you, you recognize the sign, you accept it, you feel it, you trust it. Boom, boom, boom. And so once you start working with it, it becomes second nature. Now, the trust part,
For your information, I can feel her laughing her head off at what you just said, because it's actually a lot harder for her than that. She considers me a real turtle when it comes to this stuff. But it's true. I do it fairly well. But let me ask you this. I'm getting better at it. I have. Yeah, absolutely. But why do we push it away? Why does that moment come when that you were just telling us about, and we all, I'm sure, were nodding and saying that happens to me.
Oh, I have to be careful about doing it. I remember when I was in England and I was working with some British mediums, and one of them, she goes, "Ma, do stop cross-examining every spirit that makes an appearance." Because something would come in and go, "Well, you know, maybe I really want to talk to that person," or maybe what happens is our emotions, our feelings want this to happen, our right brain, but then our left brain logic comes in. And then there's our natural skepticism. Also, it's the disbelief that has been drilled into us. Religious indoctrination. Oh, this is evil. You know, it's a demon impersonating a loved one. That one always cracks me up. Yeah, so a demon's coming along to tell you that life is eternal, your loved one's in complete bliss, they love you unconditionally, and you'll see them again when you go into the light. Ooh, sounds real demonic to me. You know, I mean, it's just absurd how people wallow in fear. But, that's also a very primeval instinct. So it's overcoming our natural skepticism and most of all, fear. People are afraid of death. We, you know, people have been taught to fear spirits. We shouldn't. Now, I was in Peru, and I was in the Andes Mountains and at a town known as Ollantaytambo. And the Quechua people live there. They are the Incas. They're the descendants. The Incas spoke a form of Quechua. And at Ollantaytambo, that was the only place one of the very few places where the Incas defeated the Spanish. And so they're real proud of that. And so I was there and I was studying archaeology and supernatural phenomenon. And this family invited me into their home. And it was really cool because their home was carved into this cliff. I mean, people had been living in this dwelling for centuries. And on the hearth, it was a multi-generational family, grandparents, parents, you know, kids, siblings, and little kids are playing on the floor. And on the hearth, there are skulls. They had human skulls. And, you know, I looked at that and, you know, and I realized, you know, and I've been to enough places around the world that you don't walk in and, you know, don't act like the typical American where you're like, "Oh my God, that's so disgusting." You know, you don't do that. And I looked at them and they were explaining to me through our translator that these were the skulls of their ancestors. They're like great grandparents. And they were so honored how the spirits of their ancestors watch over their family. Now, for an outsider to see something like that, and I mean, you know, having the skull of your grandparents in your living room on display would maybe in our culture, well, would definitely in our culture be looked at as something grotesque and hideous, whereas theirs, it was looked at as something beautiful. And so when it comes to spirit communication, we've been taught that it's spooky and it's scary. Why? Because it deals with the unknown and people naturally fear and want to block that fear of the unknown.
I think that's very true that and it's unfortunate because we do want to block the fear of the unknown. And we have a definite tendency to transform our fear into superstition. And there, here come the demons. But it seems to me that what's actually there is much more objective. But what about stories of demonic possession and dark energies? I think that has to be addressed.
Well, this is where I differ with a lot of my colleagues. I don't believe in hell. I don't believe in the devil. I don't believe in demons, and I don't believe in evil spirits. I do believe that hell exists. Hell is a myth, a metaphor, and quite real because it exists here on planet Earth. I mean, think about if you're an educated professional woman in Afghanistan right now, you very well are living in hell. What about people who are dying slowly of a terminal disease? What about parents who've lost a child? You know, there are many forms of hell. Hell is not an eternal state. Now, that's talking about hell per se. Let's talk about evil spirits and demonic possession. Once again, fear of the unknown. While I was at the Stanley, it was a really great conference. We were in the cavern beneath it during a paranormal investigation, and the investigator had his K2 meters and EVP and everything set up. And all of a sudden, everything started going off the scale. And we're all looking at the equipment. And Rocky's behind us, and she says, you know, since I was a kid, you know, watching all those scary movies, everybody's in a cave looking in one direction, and the monster comes up behind them. She goes, so she thought, well, let me turn around and see if there's anything behind us. And I hear, oh, my God. And we all turn around, and everyone goes, oh, my God. At the end of the cavern, it was a silver green light. It was undulating along the cavern wall. And there was a guy there with us, and he works at Disney in special effects. And he's looking around. He goes, this is not being projected. He goes, we can't do this. And the investigator's equipment was just everything was lighting up and all that. So I thought, well, let me walk into it. You know, here I am. I'm the medium, you know. And as I'm walking towards it, I'm thinking, well, maybe I shouldn't be doing that. You know, the Catholic in me immediately popped up like, oh, no.
But Catholic.
Another Catholic.
Are we all Catholics? Well, is this a Catholic thing?
That's because we're more open to the existence of avatars, saints,
yes,
to angels, to spirits, as opposed to chapter, line, and verse, and that's it. And all due respect to our chapter, line, and verse friends. So I walk into this energy, and it was a female. And I also go, I've felt this before. Not this particular energy, but this type of energy. I felt it in England. They refer to it as a fairy. I felt it in Japan. They refer to it as the Kami, the K-A-M-I. Felt it in Hawaii, the Metahune. And then I realized elementals are non-human spiritual intelligence. They're more aligned with animals, plants, earth. So they're not particularly interested in human beings. But when people encounter them, they immediately fear it and assume that it's some type of evil. And the cool part, Whitley, is it wafted away from me and it enveloped the investigator. And he starts going, oh my God, it's enveloped. And I go, calm down. He goes, why is she doing this? I said, she wants to know why you're so curious about her. You're studying her. She's studying you. He goes, I never thought of it that way. I go, she isn't evil at all. And then everybody calmed down and they go, it doesn't feel scary. Okay. And so that's why in paranormal investigations, I always tell people when you're approaching something, we have to abide by the scientific method. Let's be objective. Let's use our devices. Let's get our data, you know, the medium, me, or other mediums as well. Let's get our impressions down. Let's compile the data instead of like these TV shows where, you know, they show night vision goggles, they shake it around, everybody screams demon, and they're all running all over. It's like, stop that. Okay, let's be intelligent about this. That wasn't a demon or a devil or an evil spirit. It was a non-human spiritual intelligence. Now, the next part of your question, What about demonic possession? There's different types of mediums. I'm a mental medium because they transfer information to me through electromagnetic impulses that go into my brain and get converted into recognizable memories, feelings, and cultural associations. So then I can explain it to you. There's supposedly there's physical mediums, but I've yet to see one that even comes close to being authentic. But there are trance mediums, also known as channelers. Like Edgar Casey was one of those. He would go into a trance and then spirits would speak through him to give medical cures. Well, I believe that there's a lot of people, well, maybe not a lot, but there are people who are channelers, but they don't realize it. And so opportunistic spirits will speak through them or come to them. They panic, they resist, and voila, it must be demonic possession. Because what we have to realize is there's one soul per customer, okay? Nobody's taking your soul. Nobody's haunting it. Nobody's attaching it. You can't sell it. It's you. It's your EMS.
You can't sell it. That's very important to realize.
Sell it. Yeah, but opportunistic entities can temporarily use your body. But you have to realize that ultimately you're in control of the contact, not them. So that's my thoughts on this.
Now, we're going to take another break now, Free Dreamlanders. But before we do that, there's a very relevant quote here from Meister Eckhart that appears in the wonderful movie Jacob's Ladder when Jake is struggling to face the fact that he's dead. And his soul guide, who appears as a chiropractor, Louis, quotes Meister Eckhart. He says, if you're holding on and afraid of dying, you'll see demons tearing your life apart. If you've made your peace, then the demons are really angels freeing you from the world. And this is, I think, a deep truth. It is so personally important to me because I have lived this from the early days of the close encounter experience and the terror that it brought to where I am now, which is in a very different place indeed. We'll be right back.
Three words: advanced aerial threat. Who in the CIA, NSA, DIA tells at least the United States of America that we're not alone in this universe? We have never been alone in this universe.
The U.S. government really has kept that secret, not only from the American people, which is bad enough, but even kept it from itself.
The UFO community has been portrayed as conspiracy theorists and tinfoil hats, and we're crazy. And the government is now admitting that UFOs are real and disclosure is here. Suddenly, they're our friend? No.
America's defense establishment is finally admitting some of what it knows.
This could have been a chance to say we're going to collaborate with the representatives of the people in what is supposed to be a government of, by, and for the people.
If what they tell you is the truth, there is no need to withhold it from public.
We've entered a quantum age, making a leap not only in technology, but also in consciousness. Companies are now creating non-sentient replacement humans. They look just like you and I. They're intended for customer service and things such as that. But these neons, as they're called, could be more nefarious than that.
We're dealing with a fight. There are forces behind the scenes that doesn't want any of this information to come out.
There's still a lot of truth that has yet to be revealed.
I was one of those quote-unquote men in black, but I realize it's probably better now to be known as men in white, bringing truth to the topic.
The problem with the truth is the truth might be terrifying.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. We're talking to Mark Anthony. His book, The Afterlife Frequency, his website, afterlifefrequency.com. You can easily reach Mark on that website and engage with him. There's a lot of wisdom here. This is the real deal. We don't talk to fakes on Dreamland, because I've been doing this too long. I can smell them a mile away. And this is the real deal. This is someone who is seriously engaged in this and can do it. He can do it. Now, I would like to take a detour, because that's always fun in one of these conversations. And people always ask me after I've finished one of these shows, well, what about animals? And because your PR stuff has got a suggested question about this. And yeah. So I know you're interested. What about spirit animals and the spirit of animals?
Once again, animals have an energy field. They have brains. They have electromagnetic souls. You know, growing up my family wasn't conservative religiously, because when both mom and dad are mediums, you know, at dinner we'd talk about everyone from Gandhi to Jesus to Buddha. I mean, that's just how it was. But there's this human arrogance that only animals have a soul. I mean, I've heard friends of mine that are evangelicals saying, oh, well, when that dies, nothing happens. It's a different kind of energy. And it's like, no, it isn't. Because in my life, I've communicated with dogs, cats, horses, birds, rabbits, gerbils. I even communicated with a bear once. And that was really interesting. Yeah, well, I was doing a reading for this family, and they were a real country. They were like from the center part of Florida, real nice people, but you know, and they had real pronounced accents, and their father had passed, and daddy, they call him daddy. Well, daddy came through, and all of a sudden I was explaining this. I said, there's a bear, a big black bear next to your father. And the oldest son goes, well, daddy done shot himself a big old black bear once. And I'm like, okay. All right. I mean, I'd never connected with a bear before. And then it sent a message to me. And the message was, sometimes you're the predator, and sometimes you're the prey. And I was like, wow. Yeah. And it seemed like daddy and the bear were just fine. And what I found is
they were good together at this point.
They were good together at this point. I mean, there's a funny, it wasn't funny at the time, but it is now. I was doing a reading for this young lady, and her dog came through. Looked like he was like a German Shepherd or something. And then I saw a hamster. I go, oh, a hamster. And she started crying. And I go, why? She goes, I brought that hamster home from school. My dog ate it. And I'm like, oh. I mean, it was like, well, I was frightfully embarrassed. I mean, it's like, I was like, well, they seem to be okay now, you know. But I've seen a lot of this where these animals will come through. In animal communication, they're very direct. They either like you or they don't. They love you or they don't. And they will come through. They're very direct. And people say, well, it's an animal. How could it communicate? Because it's an electromagnetic soul. And it's part of the collective consciousness. Think of our EMS, our electromagnetic soul, as a drop of water. And when we die, it plunges into this eternal sea of souls, the collective consciousness. So now the soul is linked to other souls, linked to other souls, linked to other souls. And they're part of this vast intelligence, which is why when animals come through, they will convey to us messages. that are very coherent and very specific. And if you'll indulge me, in my last book, Evidence of Eternity, I was doing a group reading, and all of a sudden I zeroed in on this guy. He was like real clean cut, tough looking guy. And I said, there's a male energy, but this doesn't feel like a human. And I could see him staring at me and starting to tremble. And I said, it looks like a big German shepherd with a real black snout. You know, like some German shepherds are more black than they are. And he started nodding, and I could see like a tear in his eyes. And I said, this animal wants you to know that he reacted faster than any human could at 3 a.m. Well, the guy lost it totally. And he said, I'm a canine cop, and that was the best dog, the best partner, the best friend I ever had, Ajax. And he said that we were chasing a hardened criminal, all these cops, and the guy ran into the woods. And so all the cops were running through the woods, and I got separated from Ajax. And he said, and then I realized it was 3 a.m. He goes, and I was separated from everybody else. And then something jumped at me from behind this tree. It was the killer. He said, it hit me really hard. I was down on the ground. And he said, in the moonlight, I saw this knife. I saw the moonlight shining out this knife, and it was coming down on me. And he goes, oh my God, I'm going to die. And at that moment, this shadow comes out of nowhere. It was Ajax. And it grabbed the guy by the arm and pulled him off of him and started mauling him. And I remember he's explaining this, and the crowd of people starts cheering. I mean, it was just amazing. And Ajax saved his life. And he said, the thing I always loved about working with him is a human takes a couple seconds to observe, process, and respond, but a dog will react immediately. There's no indecision. He said, anybody, if I was with the human, he said, I'd be dead right now. He goes, that knife was coming right at me, and there was nothing I could do about it. And then the animal started giving him other information about a red pillow. He said, sorry about the red pillow. And he said, I always put this red pillow in my patrol car so Ajax could put his snout on it, because he used to drool, and he would always drool on this red pillow. And then Ajax forgave him for putting him down. And the cop was crying. He goes, that was the hardest decision of my life. He was so sick. He was in so much pain. I just couldn't bear to watch him suffer. Now, this animal gave more precise and exact information than many human spirits have. But this wasn't just any dog. This is one of those highly trained Osama bin Laden hunting dogs, you know? Yeah. And it was just really, really fascinating. Because a lot of times animals come in and they'll give you some messages. They may even give you their name and some things like that. But I'll never forget that particular reading because of the specificity that was transferred by the spirit of this amazing dog.
Well, of course, in my life, dogs, spirit dogs play a huge role. My childhood dog, Candy, has been with me for years and years. And what will happen is I'll be in bed and I'll be petting Candy. And it's just as real as if I was 9 years old again. And then I'll start to think to myself, well, gee, I wonder how old Candy is now. And I think, well, wait a minute. Wouldn't she be over 60? But she's just a little dog, and then she disappears.
Yeah.
My wife used to say, you have two wives, Whitley, me and your dog. And she's been, and then once after, one of the few times Anne appeared visibly to me, she had Candy with her on a leash. So they're there, all right, the dogs and the cats and the animals. And once I had a very vivid image of a dog in front of me, a familiar dog from my childhood who had been badly mistreated, not by me, but by others. And I told Anne about this while meditating, and she said, dog, God, you had a visit from God. And I said, oh, I have to get a proof of that. And the dog's name was Quagmire. And we went out walking a few minutes later, and there on the street corner was a car with the vanity plate QGMIRE, Quagmire. And I thought, okay, I'm on it. I get it. So they have a huge presence in this, in the afterlife. Now, one of the things that you talk about in the book that's extremely interesting is collective consciousness.
Right.
I want to know what you mean by that, because we're not quite as independent in the other level as we are here. In other words, we're not isolated. Can you talk to that?
Well, sure. And that's what I was saying about why animals are able to communicate, because they're part of the collective consciousness. The collective consciousness may be God. And I tend to believe that it is. I mean, we've all heard that expression that we're all cells in the body of God. And if everything at the most basic level, on the subatomic level, is electromagnetic energy, and with quantum entanglement, even, you know, two subatomic particles, even if they're a billion miles apart, if you do something to one, the other immediately responds. And scientists, are discussing that this is very, very real. And so, but I believe that, you know, God is more than just a compilation of spirits being connected, that there's a universal intelligence that flows through this. But that's why when we die and our EMS, our electromagnetic soul, leaves the body and connects with the afterlife frequency that is part of the collective consciousness, that's why you're never alone on the other side. They talk about the complete bliss. And it's not like it's bothersome. All the spirits I've communicated with, they're always so happy. You know, we're the ones that are miserable. They're always like, oh, I'm happy and pure energy, you know, and I asked them, well, what's that like? And the response is, well, you can't understand it. But they have given me a glimpse, Whitley, on a couple occasions. And I can only handle it for maybe 5 seconds. It's the most amazing sensation. It's my body feels like it has no substance. It's like when you're in warm water, like in the ocean or a pool, and you're underwater and you're just sort of floating there, and there's no pain, no pressure, no physicality, but it feels better than that. And it feels like I'm part of everything everywhere, and in this surge of love, energy, this, like, I'm part of everything. And I can only handle this for a few seconds because it just wipes me out. The best way I can analogize it is, think that you're a single wire and suddenly all the electricity from Manhattan is going right through you. And that's why, you know, they give me just a glimpse. That's why spirits are always so happy and they're never alone. The thing is, they can disconnect, or rather adjust their frequency to a lower vibration so that they can communicate with us. But they never complain about, oh, it's too busy or noisy here. There is a harmony to being interconnected. And that's also why many times during a reading, I'll be doing a reading for somebody and the spirits will start giving me medical information about the recipient. And I have a basic understanding of anatomy and physiology because of my background in the practice of law, but they'll start giving all types of genetic markers and information and cellular anomalies that could be going on with the person, and which many times the recipient doesn't know about. And they'll get back with me and say, oh my God, I went to the doctor and this is what it said, you know, what they found. But that's all because the collective consciousness, for lack of a better term, is like the cosmic internet, if you will.
Free Dreamlanders, we have reached that tragic moment in your lives when the show is over for you. We are talking to Mark Anthony, his book, his wonderful new book, and look him up online and get his other books too, because there is obviously a lot of wisdom here and a lot of very real experience. Afterlife Frequency, his website is afterlifefrequency.com. You can reach him there. It's a perfectly beautiful, well-built website, thank God, so many of them aren't. And you can engage with him because he does this. And we're going to learn more about Mark as a psychic in the third half hour. And we're going to also talk about something very, very important, which is spirit situational awareness. How do we actually build a new relationship with spirit? Because we can. We don't have to live in this illusion of isolation, which we are trapped in by the very nature of our civilization. We don't have to. So Free Dreamlanders, thank you very much for being with us on Dreamland. Subscribers, we will keep on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.